Thanks, Ara. Next up, we have Paula Johnson, a curator at the Smithsonian's National Museum of American History, where she oversees the food history and marine resources collections. Johnson was on the team that collected Julia Child's Home Kitchen in 2001 and co-curated the Bon Appetit exhibition 2002 to 2012. I loved that exhibition. I'm sure many of us feel the same way. As project director and co-curator of the new exhibition, Food, Transforming the American Table, she has helped shape the museum's research, collecting, exhibitions, and programming around food history. Johnson, a folklorist and public historian, has conducted field research on many topics and published two books on the Chesapeake Bay. She has worked in museums since 1981. Welcome, Paula.
Thank you, Amanda. Now it's my turn to find, there we go. Okay. Welcome, everyone. It's great to see the room filling up. We had a very early start, so it's wonderful to see so many folks out there now. I'm really delighted to be part of this panel. I can see already how what we've been talking about we all relate to each other, and I can't wait to get to the conversation in a bit. But I am here today. My focus is on food history at the Smithsonian's National Museum, where over the past several years, the museum has very deliberately deepened and broadened its attention to food and culinary history, paralleling the growth of food studies in academia and the widespread interest in food-related topics and issues that we've seen among journalists, policymakers, and the general public. Food history has emerged for us as an effective lens for examining many aspects of American history in a cross-disciplinary and very accessible way for our public. For purposes of this panel, I'm going to focus on one of our new initiatives, a regularly scheduled program that blends history with a live cooking demonstration inside the museum. This is a brave new world for us. You know, having fire in the middle of the museum is always, you know, exciting. And we believe this is also a brave new world for our public. It's but one example of our work that is really changing the conversation about history at the museum. So I want to take just a moment to connect how this idea of cooking in the museum emerged out of our research, our collecting, and our exhibition efforts. And of course, I'm happy to give credit where credit is due, and that would be to our muse, Julia Child, America's beloved cooking teacher, author, television star. As Amanda noted, the museum collected Julia Child's kitchen, all 1,200 parts and pieces of it from her home in Cambridge, Massachusetts, back in 2001. The kitchen is and remains one of the museum's most popular objects, and it's been on view by and large for the past 15 years. First in this dedicated gallery, and then since 2012 within a much larger exhibition that explores some of the big changes in American food since 1950, Food Transforming the American Table. Our team, that we always work in teams, where it's a very collaborative type of work, working in the museum. Our team had always harbored a dream, though, to not only display Julia's kitchen, where she cooked for family and friends for about 40 years and where three of her television programs were filmed, but to create an adjacent space where we could actually do, you know, what she did best, which is engage everybody in a dynamic exploration of ingredients, of culinary techniques, recipes, of traditional knowledge and history. And since July of 2015, we've been able to do just that with our demonstration kitchen, one that was specially designed and built for us, which in essence carries out Julia Child's legacy in a dynamic, sensory, and experiential way. So thus began an ambitious experiment 2 years ago almost to the day, a program we prototyped called Food Fridays, where every Friday for 6 months we presented not one, but two cooking demonstrations framed around a historical topic, an artifact, a book, an event, or a person. In terms of concept development, we ensured that there was always a very strong component that reflected the museum's research program, its collections, its exhibitions. We worked with partners to make it happen. We're not only collaborative on the inside, but also with lots of other people on the outside. Sur La Table, Le Creuset, and others donated all of the cookware and the utensils that we use. Wegmans provided all of the food each week. And we worked with chefs whose time was covered by their employers, Wegmans, Sur La Table, Restaurant Associates, and the Académie de Cuisine. There's a Smithsonian host who was also the main researcher on the project. We worked very closely together, Jessica Carbone, who is seen here with holding the mic. And she has a background in cookbook editing. She learned from Judith Jones, you know, Julia Child's editor. But she also has a background in theater, which is fantastic because she turned out to be not only a terrific researcher, but a host for what was essentially a live program without a set script. Which isn't to say that there was no script at all, but you know, when you're cooking, things happen. You gotta, you know, go with it. So Jessica produces extensive research notes and a heavily annotated timeline that follows the steps in the cooking demo for each program. So in terms of our goals for audience engagement, we were working to provide a really different kind of program that would involve our audience in thinking about food history, thinking about culture, about gender, about race, about region, in a more dynamic, interactive way. Among our challenges, cooking in the middle of the museum means we have a killer exhaust fan. You can see it above the cooking island. But it quickly removes all of the olfactory dimension of cooking, which is kind of, you know, too bad. Because we really wanted this to be more sensory. But man, you know, that fan is amazing. And also, since we're not licensed food professionals, we really can't serve the food we cook from the stage. But we are able to work with our cafe chef to prepare dishes for purchase in the museum cafe. So we jumped in with both feet on July 5th, 2015, with a chef from San Francisco, Chef Curtis Akins. And he cooked dishes from his Georgian childhood, basically set a very high bar for our subsequent programs. He proved to us that there was an audience that was very interested in hearing about people's backgrounds, about their stories, their recipes from the past, and to watch them prepare food in the museum. He also proved that our plaza setup could happen. You know, you prototype things, you build something, you try it out, and you're just very relieved when it works the way you think it's going to work. So within our prototyping period of the first 6 months, we produced 23 unique programs on such diverse topics as food movements that changed America. So on the 46th anniversary of Woodstock, we prepared some signature foods from the festival, from the Free Kitchen. We explored how food at Woodstock reflected the period's changing notions about food access and quality. And, you know, we also discovered that there were some of our colleagues who were actually there and they had their own tales to tell about food at Woodstock, or not food at Woodstock, everything else. We also did a program on Puerto Rico cultural traditions. Chef Alex Strong, who is a restaurant associate and works at the World Bank, shared some of her favorite recipes from her childhood in Puerto Rico and growing up in the Bronx. There were lots of these amazing, great stories about the differences between ingredients in Puerto Rico and in the U.S., how that affected a dish, and what, you know, her abuela had to say about it. She was not happy about what was available at the bodega in the Bronx. This program really allowed us to look at the blend of Spanish and African and Taino and American influences that have shaped this cocina creole. Each program involves library and archival research and a great deal of planning and coordination, and you know, other members of the staff who are supporting the whole effort. But I'm showing you these notes. These are the notes for just one program. We are archiving the research notes, the bibliographies, the photographs, and the recipes to ensure that this foundation of material will not be lost. It's a valuable resource, and we want to make sure we hang on to it. So throughout the prototyping period, we were constantly evaluating, seeking feedback from the staff, from the audiences, and from our partners, and we then used that feedback to recalibrate the program and have developed a new model, one that is makes a huge difference for staff sanity. It's one program a month instead of one every week. But this allows us for deeper research and a tighter focus for what we're doing. And it also allows for a more manageable media plan, social media, and the like. We're able to really advertise these things in a different way. So our most successful programs have these ingredients, if you will. When a chef has personal stories that connect to the larger history and the food and the recipe. For example, March 12th of last year on Museum Day Live, which was a program focusing on women and girls of color, and it was an NEH White House and Smithsonian program. And we welcome to the stage Alice Randall and Carolyn Randall Williams. Alice is at Vanderbilt, and Carolyn at the time was at West Virginia University, a mother-daughter duo that had just published their book, Soul Food Love. They cooked from and talked about their family's soul food traditions, which were passed down over four generations of women. So as they cooked, they discussed how the ingredients and the styles of cooking reveal the food's fundamental role in their history, from slavery to the Harlem Renaissance, from the Civil Rights Movement to the present day. Some of their stories brought the plaza to silence, and you have to just imagine a plaza holds about 300 people sitting in chairs, and it was packed with young women of color who had participated in various activities throughout the day. And they talked about how, for example, the kitchen was at times a site of violence and assault for black women cooks during slavery. How segregation in Memphis led a grandmother to form a very strong social club for African American women. They carried forward lots of ideas about what it means to be a hostess in terms of food as well as the social rituals. Our programs are also most successful when there are connections to larger topics and issues of interest. For example, foods of the Civil Rights Movement, where we asked, what were the foods that nourished the Civil Rights Movement? We cooked with a chef again here from Surmontab, and these were dishes that fed the organizers of the sit-ins, the boycotts, and the marches. She showed some of the ways in which Southern flavor is developed, often with homemade ingredients and slow and low cooking. We discussed the importance of these foods to the students, to the churches, and to the civil rights organizations of the period. You can see that after the program with the public, there's a lot of dialogue. People swarm the stage and talk to the chef, talk to our historian, a host. And then backstage, there's a moment where family and friends can taste the food, but also to connect with each other. Our program is also strong in what the museum does. Presidential history is something that is always of interest to people who come to the American History Museum. So we did a program on Abraham Lincoln in the kitchen, basically comparing the childhood food traditions of Lincoln and Mary Todd, very different backgrounds in terms of class, where they grew up, Indiana, Kentucky, a homestead, and in a large plantation that was served by enslaved people. So. So we talked about those two different experiences and how that played into the kinds of food from their childhood and what they brought forth together in the White House. So we cooked, yeah, chicken fricassee and the corny cake. And if you look, here's the recipe for Mary Todd's corny cake. All of our recipes are online. And this kind of shows the dimensions of the Atlantic world. I mean, sugar, vanilla, there was even some rum in it. And so we were able to talk about where those ingredients came from and why they were something that was just regular for Mary Todd, but certainly not for Abraham Lincoln in Indiana. Programs are also very strong when we collaborate with other Smithsonian bureaus. And this is an example. We brought Chef Jerome Grant, who is the rock star of the National Museum of African American History and Culture, to our stage. And he cooked food in the Great Migration, food that reflects the culinary changes that emerged from that large movement of people. This is a recipe that he cooked, oxtail pepper pot. He also cooked up collard greens. And the box lunch, the lunch that migrants carried with them from the south to the north. And then finally, programs that connect us to community. Yeah, we are Washington, D.C., it's full of everybody, but we have a community too. And so we welcomed Chef Rock Harper to the stage a few weeks ago for the Foods of Jazz. The museum is a very active jazz history program, and so we combined that with a cooking demonstration. And he cooked up three dishes from three different centers of jazz history, from New Orleans, from Kansas City, and from Harlem. Those are the dishes that he prepared. This program was also attended by some 30 culinary students at DC Central Kitchen. And they were all there kind of seeing the rock star himself, cook, but they were also learning about communicating with the public. And our stage, we were able to offer that as kind of a learning experience for them. And they also signed up for our food history newsletter. And I'll tell you how to do that too. I have tried to show you, give you a taste of how food history at the Smithsonian is not just a niche topic, but a generative starting point for discussions about race and gender, innovation, tradition, justice, community, family. We are doing as much as we possibly can. Cooking up history allows us to explore diverse traditions with people who have those personal stories and who can connect their experiences and their knowledge to the larger national narratives. These programs help inspire people to rethink and reimagine what a museum is and what it can do. We don't claim to have all the answers. We're still working on it because that's the nature of what we do. We're really trying to develop this dynamic program by being open to experimentation. What we are demonstrating is that food can be a very powerful starting point for examining many, many aspects of American history. So I will stop here and look forward to our discussion. Thank you very much.
Thanks, Paula, and I absolutely recommend signing up for those emails from the exhibition. I get them all the time and I love reading them. They're a great break from the workday and way to imagine what else is going on in DC. It's really, really exciting.